17th Annual Principia Film Festival. Yeah. My name is John, in case you don't know me, and I've had the great privilege of being the film club president for the last 2.5 years now, and putting on this festival has been probably the best part about that position. So 17 years, it's been going on quite a long time. It's changed a lot since it began, or so I'm told. I obviously was not there at the beginning. I was 5. But it's really great to be a part of its history. Speaking of history, this is also the first year we are live streaming it. So a huge welcome to everyone at home, wherever you are, for watching. Now, before we begin, I would just like to give a huge thank you to each and every one of you for being here. Just showing up and watching our films and videos tells us creators out there that our work matters. For a lot of us, this is the only chance we really get to show it with a community and show it to a large audience. And we've poured countless hours into them. So it really does mean a lot, and it makes the night special for us. So thank you. All right, thank you. All right, please help me give a warm welcome to our hosts for the evening, Noah Osler and Hunter Hummel.
All right, quick PSA before we begin. We're gonna need everyone to be in their cohorts for this evening so that we don't get shut down by the administration. So if you are not in your cohort right now, if you could stand up and move to your cohort, and we'll give you 30 seconds to do that. Also, an advisory to anyone watching on YouTube Live, this show will contain some mature humor and mature themes. So if you have grandmas watching, cover their eyes and ears. Yep.
Well, great. So me and Noah really want to welcome you all to the first ever Principia Adult Film Festival.
No,
we are so excited.
That's not it. That is horrible. And also next week, and we're hosting that too.
Yeah, so thanks for the reminder. Speaking of hosting, me and Noah, I think for transparency, I need to get something off of my chest. You may be wondering why me and Noah are hosting this event. You may think it's because we're good looking, we're devilishly charming, we're funny, or that we like to do this, and none of that is true at all. So the real story was, about 2 weeks ago to this day, I got a text from John Woodall in a group chat with Noah, and John goes, "Hey Hunter and Noah, are you guys willing to host the Principia Film Festival?" Now I like John, also this is the first time John is hearing about this, I like John a lot, and I'm willing to do almost anything for him. But there's no way in hell I'm ever going to host the Principia Film Festival. So I actually drafted almost an essay-length text that was very polite, saying, "Hey, John, there's no way I'm going to do this. This sounds awful." And as I'm about to hit send, and this is true, I get a ding on my phone, and Noah had responded. And Noah's exact text goes, "Hey, John, Hunter and I would love to, but I'm only willing to host if Hunter does." So he put me in a pickle, and that's the only reason I'm here today. So thank you for having us.
John, first of all, we apologize. That was not meant to be mean at all. For real, guys, we're going to have a lot of fun tonight. Most of these are student films with some exceptions, so it's probably going to be a little shitty. But
that's the adult humor. if you guys are wondering what tonight looks like at all, what the order is, what the structure is, hopefully you got a program, you can look to that, because Noah and I have no idea what we're doing.
We know, so, like, as much as you do, and probably a little bit less.
So with all that being said, without further...
Without much more things to say.
Without the first thing to do, we're going to start with the first movie,
the
Moonlight.
Intro.
Thank you. Do you think you hide at all?
No. I never thought of it myself. Yeah, in some ways for sure. It's kind of cool. I remember one of my friends was saying that my artwork is sneaky. Like, he approached one of the paintings and he was like, as I approached, like, things just started popping out. Like, they were hidden before, but the more I looked at them, then they started revealing it. I knew I was attracted to it in other paintings. I didn't know I was doing it myself. It's kind of subconscious. Yeah, I am not that type of person that feels the necessity or have the big attention or something. Like, I hate attention. What I think I've noticed, I change a lot, and I feel like my identity is kind of this changing character, so I keep surprising myself. Didn't know where I was going with this one. Kind of proved through the process that I can't go about that kind of things. That doesn't bring me anything back to me. What do you really want to make? What excites you? What do you want to say? I think that was one of his questions. And hearing that, and it was like, kind of kicked my ass, you know. Like, yeah, what am I trying to say? So I was pondering about that, weeks, I think. making these series of the Latvian countryside is that I feel like everybody has this kind of place that they've attached to, because I want to share how special those memories and how special the atmosphere is there. I have these memories of this place, so really this series of the countryside could be anybody's home. That's what I'm going after. I'm just there to bring that emotion to people, that you're home.
Smile.
I'll be back Tuesday. I love you. They're dangerous, I know. But soon I'll be gone. I said this week will be my last. And then I'll be done. Then we can leave.
Hey, did you see the new schedule?
No, what changed?
You're working like 12 straight hours, dude.
Huh.
Yeah, it's weird.
Shit.
Okay, so you guys are all good to go. We're off. Good luck.
Bye. Bye, guys.
Nina, please, run away with me.
Hello, and welcome to the pub's first 12-hour shift. What are you eating tonight?
What is that? Oh no, did I drop a disgusting little piece of lettuce?
You're all I've ever wanted.
Oh, pero Guggenheim, no, no puedo, no puedo, mi padre, mi padre.
It's a slimy, insignificant, nothing piece of lettuce. That is so gross.
Can I ask you something? Are those your eyes or your nipples?
Okay, chicken quesadilla with guac. You want anything else?
Ay, ay, ay. ¿Qué es eso? ¿Un ladrón?
You know what? I gotta stand up to you. What a dumb, smelly, processed piece of lettuce you are. Nina and I are in love!
Ay, ay, ay.
Insignificant. Oh, you taste like a 2.7 GPA. Disgusting.
Hello, and welcome to the pub's first 12-hour shift. What do you want at 3 a.m.? Because I want to make it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's not the first 12-hour shift, but let me get some of that breakfast menu.
The breakfast menu?
Yeah, breakfast menu, eggs. Let me get a few eggs.
I don't think we have any eggs. Yeah, you're right. I don't know how I've never noticed that. Okay, can I get an entry order?
PJ.
Okay, coming right up. PJ, do you want a receipt?
I always want a receipt.
PJ, your eggs are ready. PJ! PJ! PJ, where'd you go? PJ!
Child, you were so forlorn.
Fairy God, Donkey, is that you?
Boone, everyone's at the rave underneath Crafton.
Yeah, I'd like to go, but I just don't have enough drip.
Let me help you. Bippity boppity shoo!
You didn't have to cut me off. Think I like it never happened, and that we were nothing. I don't even need your love, but you treat me like a stranger, and I feel so low. No, you didn't have to stoop so low.
For you.
Thank you so much.
Come celebrate with us while there's still time.
Hey, Georgie, my boy, it's your boss, Polly Giuseppe, a.k.a. PJ. Not to be confused with that weird dude that wears denim. I'm pretty sure he's a demon. Anyway, how was your day?
Yeah, my day was good.
I'm so relieved to hear it. Well, the guy who's running this 12-hour pub operation is gonna cost me a lot of money if it goes through, all right? I want you to take him out. Maybe make him so he's dead now.
Okay, perfect. I'll go tell him the assignment.
Oh, I need you to do that for me. I love you. Mwah.
Woke up this morning, got some gabagoo. And then I woke up the next day and got some gabagoo.
Hey, you made some very powerful people very angry.
Bro, I am literally just trying to do my job.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, God, your head. Oh, no.
Somebody's gonna come looking for me. There's gonna be an Amber Alert.
Amber Alert, Amber Alert. I'm at the drop, ready when you are, boss man.
Hello, ladies. Hello. Thank you for meeting me on such short notice.
So what's the deal? What does PJ want with him?
Well, that doesn't matter. The less you know, the better.
Your job is to rough this guy up. We need him to talk a little less, you know what I'm saying? Maybe be more unconscious. Less talky-talky, more deady-deady, you know what I'm saying? With the fishes sleeping underground.
So here's the payment. This is my gratitude, PJ's gratitude, right? Don't think too much about it, right? This is a Christmas present for you. Let's find it real quick. That can be for you. We never saw each other.
Look what the salmon dragged in.
Oh no. Oh God. Oh Jesus.
Yes.
Oh, God. Please. God.
Take
I promise. Whatever, PJ. Oh. Oh. Oh, God. Who hired you? What's going on?
If you have to ask, you already know.
PJ. Oh, God. Guys, I think my life is in danger.
It is.
Hey, you guys are funny. I've been double-crossed like four times tonight. Two of those should cancel out. That's just PEMDAS. Okay. Every 10 years, I get myself a little snack, and I stay out of everyone's business. But you guys had to just go and ruin it. So that's how we doing things. With guns? Okay. But I just gotta know one thing. Who's shooting first?
Yo, last night
man,
was crazy.
So many hot Cheetos, dude.
Remember
was
when
so
we had
funny,
that briefcase and we beat up that wizard?
Hey, he's waking up, guys. He's waking up.
Oh, so like a prank, bro.
Prank,
ultra prank.
Oh, yeah,
prank,
what the fuck?
Gonna prank him again sometime soon.
Coal industry provides 40% of all U.S. electricity, but has recently been losing market share.
Natural gas is so much cheaper.
Solar right now is cheaper than coal.
Feels like the end of coal.
Wall Street doesn't want to fund another coal-fired power plant.
Wet coal ash out of these huge unlined bits in the ground.
And we have ended, finally, the war on clean, beautiful coal.
Coal also contributes to 4 out of the 5 leading causes of death in the United States.
Everybody's going to be hurt by climate change.
An America run solely on fossil fuels should not be the vision we have for our children and our grandchildren.
This move toward clean energy didn't happen by chance.
But the era of King Coal is coming to a close.
I was born in Hartford, Illinois. Grew up in Alton. The subdivision I lived in, the back end of the subdivision, was the bank of the Wood River Creek, which we considered our playground. Yeah, we were kids, and we decided one summer that we would build ourselves a raft and float it just as far as we could. We floated it to the Mississippi River and actually pushed it over the spillway there at the power plant. When we were kids, it looked big and ominous, like, you know, the evil castle.
Wood River Station represents the era of industry in the United States, which is an era of very big optimism for the future. Many middle-class Americans would be able to get a job at a place like this. It would provide them with a decent living wage and a lifetime of work if they wanted to.
Most people in this area know about the power plant. It has had several different kind of owners through the years. I remember as a youth, it was Illinois Power. Ameren came in and owned it for a while. It's been a major supplier of electric for as long as I can remember, and I've been around for a long time in the village. I've lived here my whole life. The economic impact of that plant for this area and for the tax base of communities is enormous.
The coal industry
in the United States, there are many things attached to it. There's romance attached to it. There's mythology attached to it. There's this American dream attached to it, right? And I think the coal companies have known for a long time that their days are numbered.
In 2014, I think, you know, by then the writing was on the wall that the Wood River plant was going to be closing in the near future. We actually had a town hall, and Robert Flexon, the CEO of Dynegy, you know, flew in his private jet and came in and said, "You have nothing to worry about. We're not closing the plant." He made a lot of promises.
The company, as you might expect, was really non-transparent with its workers and the people who were going to be impacted. They kept telling them that the plant would not close.
That meeting was in January of 2015.
At the end of 2015, Dynegy announced its future plans for the retirement of the Wood River Power Station.
Initially, when they were going to give the six-month notice, they contacted the Alton mayor and they contacted the Wood River mayor. They had an Alton mailing address, but clearly on the side of the building it said Wood River Power Plant. So they hedged their bet and they invited the Wood River mayor and the Alton mayor, and they still missed because it was East Alton. As many years as they've been there, their management really didn't know where they were.
When you want to close the power plant, I know that you do have to ask the grid operator, and they can actually say, no, you need to keep running.
They closed because of the environment that they were trying to make money in.
A lot of coal plants are shutting down simply because of the economics, that burning coal is not as competitive as it once was.
Coal has been uneconomic for really decades if you count the external costs, health impacts of burning coal in terms of the air pollution.
I attended a meeting where they said they were going to give notice to the federal government that they were intending on closing. They had a 6-month period to be reviewed. Then in the 6 months, the federal government said, we'll be fine without this power plant. It's okay for you to close it. And then they did.
That was in the spring of 2016.
When you're talking about someone's livelihood, 6 months is not a lot of time to figure out, you know, if you're gonna have to uproot your family. What are the opportunities in this area? Good jobs are hard to find.
When it closed down, there was a real impact to our village government. We effectively lost 23% of our total property tax base. I think the plant itself had 90 employees. These jobs had an average salary of $100,000. So you're talking about a $9 million payroll. The whole River Bend area suffered because that money was being pumped through our communities.
There needs to be some plan to transition these communities in a healthy way, and of course the workers too at the plant.
So the closure of the Wood River plant was not done in a just manner. You know, it did not follow these principles of a just transition. The company announced the retirement of the plant and really only gave the workers and the community 6 months notice.
Looking at what's happening for decommissioning and deconstruction, what we found is that there really isn't all that much there.
And we worry about it because we know there's a lot of toxic material attributed to power plants.
But in terms of like what we would think of as real regulation that has process or the level of detail you'd expect out of regulation, it's really not there as far as we can tell.
Even though the Wood River Dynegy plant has been shuttered, the coal ash has been left behind.
Burning coal produces ash, and that ash is toxic. It has a lot of heavy metals.
Burning coal 24/7 for decades produces a lot of coal ash. Coal ash was put in the national spotlight in 2008 when a coal ash pond in Kingston, Tennessee, failed. And that created essentially a landslide of coal ash that went through a community.
In one of the worst environmental disasters in U.S. history.
The coal ash ponds they're huge.
Next to them is the Wood River Creek, from which it gets its name. There is one berm that separates that creek from the first of those ponds.
With levees, sometimes it's not a matter of if, but when they will fail.
A lot of these ponds aren't lined.
We knew from the monitoring wells that we were getting contamination in our groundwater from the coal ash.
Things that we see a lot are things like arsenic, things like chromium, boron is the main coal ash indicator. There's 1.6 million cubic yards of coal ash at these ponds. That would be like one, maybe one and a quarter Empire State Buildings. And as coal plants close, we're facing the moment when we have to decide, what are we actually going to do about these? Two methods that are often considered are either capping a coal ash pond. The other method is removal. And that's where you would excavate this ash, and capping is significantly cheaper of these two options. And I know communities have concerns about, you know, if this ash pond is still there, well, you know, that's maybe prime property for another bit of industry to come in and, you know, bring economic benefit to a community. You know, we have a problem here that we've been building up for a very, very long time.
The environmental regulations aren't as strong as they should be around coal ash.
There are coal ash ponds all over this state and all over this country. They're not going to go away on their own. Somebody has to take responsibility, and it should not be the communities that were harmed in the first place.
In 2019, we found out that this property was sold to a redeveloping company called Commercial Liability Partners. Their job is to essentially flip the property, deal with the environmental issues on the site, and then sell it to somebody else.
We reached out to Commercial Liability Partners. We went through every available means. Nothing. Got no response, no answer.
Private businesses are not going to be more transparent than they think it has adds value to their project.
Virginia and I met with the mayor of East Alton to figure out how they had interacted with this company. And CLP handed them a one-page handout that could have been strategy for closure plan for just about anything. There were no details, there was no timeline, there were no projections, there was no safety plan. CLP had hired a public relations firm. If you've hired Fleshman Hillard, you're expecting a problem.
We got one email from them, and it was essentially a form letter that didn't respond at all. It was just sort of like, oh, thank you for your correspondence or something along those lines. There's been no engagement, no conversation at all.
All we wanted to do was have a conversation with the company about what its plans were.
To sit down with them and talk with them and talk about the project, I don't think they're obligated to do that.
There was a disastrous coal plant demolition with a stack implosion in the Little Village neighborhood of Chicago.
And that happened in April 2020. And the company demolished the smokestack improperly. And a cloud of the dust from the smokestack blew through this community. And, you know, like it'd be like opening the door and, you know, like whiteout conditions.
There was no notice given to the community. There was no fugitive dust mitigation.
So what can we do about this here in Wood River to make sure that something like this doesn't happen?
Commercial Liability Partners is connected with Hilco, and Hilco is the player that took down the Crawford plant. Coal plant demolitions have gone incredibly wrong. Same scenario. Ties to the same companies.
Corporations tend to do what's profitable. And if they can buy a contract and make money by cutting corners or not complying even, they will do that.
You know, we found out that they had a permit, and that permit said, okay, well, if you demolish it, you have to give 3 months notice. We found out from sort of through the grapevine that they were demolishing it in a week. And so that 3 months notice never happened.
Department of Transportation officials said that Illinois 143 will be closed to all traffic as there it goes. Once again, this is the old East Alton Wood River plant there. That smoke will be spreading for some time now.
Yeah.
They've got hoses out there. I don't think they're doing much.
I was going to say, I don't think the hoses are...
We need another hose.
Too powerful against all that smoke. Yes. Spiritus Wrecking Company in St. Louis is the one doing this demolition this morning.
East Alton.
Mm-hmm.
Julia Avery spoke with the police chief there about some last-minute changes to the demolition plan.
Due to concerns raised by the lock and dam of like, hey, wait a second, like we operate a large impoundment structure that contains water and you're about to blow up some stuff, they decided to not plug the smokestacks yet.
So I don't get caught up too much on nostalgia. It's unfortunately, not every structure is going to last forever. And we have to pick and choose how we remember the history and yet not hinder the future.
You have to, you know, take down those structures and make the land usable for something else.
They have a practical approach, which I understand completely. They say, let's just clear the site completely. That way we can redevelop it and we don't have this, you know, these smokestacks to deal with. But I think we lose something very tangible in terms of just our visual world. We tear down these unique, solidly built structures that were made by artists and craftsmen. These small communities like Alton, for example, attracted the majority of their population during these big industrial booms. So they really created communities like Alton. I think of all art forms, architecture is probably one of the purest art forms that we have. It's a true reflection of our hopes and our dreams and our plans for the future in any given time in history. To me, seeing anything old demoed makes me very sad. It's kind of dramatic seeing something like that demoed. At the same time, it's heartbreaking because you know the architecture that's being lost. I knew it was coming and I could not bring myself to watch it because there's a little sentimental part of me that would have been very sad watching it, even though I understand why.
I'm not sure that the regular citizen understands how every decision by an industry that closes impacts them. But there's no question it does. We won't ever have the tax base that we had when there was a power plant there, but we'd like to have some other business there to contribute to our tax base. While we have the infrastructure in place, we have all the transmission lines, we have everything it seems like we need. We just need a different source of energy. Why can't we do green energy? And I was told that green energy was not an option at that location.
When Dynegy Vistra sold the plant, it was specifically stated in the contract that there was to be no clean energy development on site.
And we're just going to have to figure out ways to move on. It's really important that we get something in that 400 acres. So we're still a couple years away from that. First thing first, we have to get it cleaned up.
Well, the big picture in the United States, and I think across the world on coal plants, is that, you know, there's a death knell.
This is where we're going. And so this conversation we're having is going to happen in every single community where there's a power plant. And maybe not all of them are as close to people as other ones are. But if we have no process at all, it means that the only way to get good outcomes at every one of those sites is going to be to have community members raising a stink, you know, writing letters to the editor, like calling EPA at every single one of these sites. And that's just not a process, you know, that's not a burden that we should be putting on our community members. And of course, it's not just about the plant demolition. It's about local economies. It's about support for communities and workers. We don't have a lot of time left.
Eliminating coal from the climate crisis picture by 2030 is the first step. We started off in the late 2000s with 530 existing coal plants at the end of the Bush-Cheney years. We have retired or garnered commitments to retire 339 of those. And so there are only 191 left. You have these debates and arguments about the health and environmental impacts. You can't argue with the economics anymore. It's just it's just cheaper to go with clean energy. The movement to stop the climate crisis is a people powered movement.
What would make somebody like me go to all this effort? I'm not paid by anybody.
I do what I do because I can't do anything else. If I have any thread of morality or believe anything about the sanctity of life, then I am compelled to behave this way. Sometimes the work is discouraging, but the consequences are too dire not to do it.
This is really all about, how do we not just take care of this planet, but the people on this planet.
This area, Alton Godfrey, it's my home. It's my family's home, very deep roots here. I grew up, creek walking, bluff climbing, water skiing on the Mississippi. And it was just, a source of pride too.
We're not the crown of creation. We're not separate from everything else around us. We're a process that's inside of a process. And if we keep acting as if we're not, Mother Nature bats last, and she always hits a home run.
Welcome back to another video. It's Friday, and today I thought I'd come to the most common area at my school and interview a bunch of college men about what they really know about girls. So stay tuned and keep watching if you want to know what they said. Let's go. Do you guys mind being videoed?
I do.
Yes.
Do you really?
I do, but I won't mind today.
Okay, I'll ask you guys both questions.
Okay. Man, I got all the answers.
On average, how many times a month do girls get their period?
How many times a month?
Yeah.
I have no idea. Hmm. Once?
A month? I don't know. I mean, I want to say
five times.
Sometimes, like in a week.
What? Not,
like, no, I don't way. Know.
I okay. said once.
About three.
One and a half.
Once?
Like once? Like once or twice?
On the female body, where is the pina?
I have no clue. No idea.
The what?
The pina.
The pina?
Yeah.
Lower south left quadrant.
I have no idea. I have no idea. What the heck is a pina?
I have no idea.
Can you take a guess?
No, I have no idea.
Do you know what this is?
Yeah, that is what the dentist used to separate my teeth.
I like
to get checkups for girls. It's either that or the other one.
That's an eyelash curler.
Oh, is that for like your lashes?
Very good.
Doesn't it have to do something like with eyelashes or something?
They use, I've seen that on TikTok. It's for the gynecologist. Or is that the, oh, you reversed me. That's the eyelash thing.
Do you know what it's called?
Eyelash curler.
Yeah, okay, good job. Do you know what this is?
Yeah, it's a balloon.
A douche, maybe? I don't know.
I have no idea. A funnel?
Plunger.
I forget what it's actually called, but it's a period cup or something. Where it catches all of the fluids.
No idea what that is.
What finger should you use to apply eye cream?
Your middle finger.
Middle.
Pointer what? Finger?
Middle finger.
Okay. On average, how many times a year should men go to the gynecologist?
None? I feel like none's a good answer there.
Probably 2 to 3, right. Just to be safe.
Have you gone yet this year?
No, unfortunately I haven't. Right. It's just too early in the year, yeah. But right. I have to get an appointment.
Shouldn't it be like a once a year thing?
Like once or twice?
I'd agree. Do you girls fart, yes or no?
Do girls fart? Yeah. Of course.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure.
Oh, okay.
On average, how many times a week do girls poop?
Depends on the girl. I'd say on average for every girl, probably like -2.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yep, of course.
I am dead.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Okay, thanks, Seb.
All right.
Say bye.
Bye.
Dancing around in the rain again, 'cause you said that I was my only friend. Playing with the flowers that I picked myself, because I know they won't come from anybody else. Wrap myself up to hold my hands from the biting ice that you made them stand. Trace my footsteps in the water, 'cause you said when you left I'd be lost forever and ever. Making room for another in these better days, days, days. I'm still moving cities and I'm still causing storms. I don't know if you know this, but when I shoot, I score. Took this pain inside of me, turned it into gold. I made this exothermic, now watch my heart explode.
I deserve this. I deserve it all. I deserve this. Whoa. I'm still moving cities and I'm still causing storms. I don't know if you know this. I don't know.
I don't know, I shouldn't call her an ancestor. She's just my great-great-aunt. And she was a really cool individual, never married, traveled as a young woman independently, and did her art. I think that's the surprising thing that I'm finding, is that I think my art relates to her more than I realize. Like, the things that I just do sort of flippantly with my brush or, like, am very quick about and don't think about end up kind of stylistically looking very close to hers. Like, she has this one beautiful kind of like nude sketch of a woman with her back to her. I don't know, I remember it used to be on the staircase in my childhood home, and I would always look at it and just feel like so mesmerized by the smooth, confident lines and simple like charcoal. A concept that I've sort of been grappling with and wanting to see grow is just like the connection of art and environmentalism. Because for me, art should be to highlight, you know, certain like pathways of life that are more productive. I don't want to be someone who's just like consumed with like my ideas and my expression and all of that. It's more just like seeing what's already here and how I can, and you know, bring that out and help educate others. And that's really what I want to do, is reach out to people and be better at putting myself aside. I've never really had this sort of like complex of like I need more say or I need more power, and I've felt very heard in my own family unit growing up, and have a very strong mother who's taught me that, you know, the typical roles of male and female are not true at all. So I've felt very confident growing up with like my place in society and the things that I'm capable of, and it honestly confuses me more when I learn from history that women aren't typically seen that way. But I think that's what you kind of mean when you say, like, when stories are uncovered and unearthed and shared and stuff like that, people grow in confidence. And I think that's because womanhood and female empowerment is relevant throughout all ages, and it's there. It's not something that, you know, it's something that's covered up by men in history books, basically, but we're always strong and present. And I don't like focusing on it too much, because I feel like when you hone in on something like that, you distract yourself from what you can do. I wouldn't want my work or my life to be about saying I'm a woman and I'm also doing this. Because, I mean, we're just individual beings.
You guys hear me? Yeah great. That was way better than I expected. that was so good. Yeah, congratulations to everybody who did that. I mean, PJ's ballad, that was just a tearjerker. Can we just give one more round of applause for everybody, you know, for those great movies? So something I should just note now, Noah had to leave. He had a prior engagement. He just got engaged, so he had to go. And I also found a program, so I now know what I'm doing. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're actually going to open up voting. So for tonight, we're giving out awards. We have four different awards in total, 3 judges award, and then one... John, it says it's no longer accepting responses. Great, well then I'm gonna explain the other part. What we're also gonna do is we're also gonna have a Q&A with the creators while everyone's voting. It'll be around, you know, 5 to 10 minutes. So what's gonna happen is if you, you know, submitted a film to the film festival, could you please come up here? And just, you can go ahead and just stand right in front of the stage. Oh, there's gotta be more. Yeah, just PJ's ballad. Oh my gosh, I thought it was gonna end like every other minute. It's great. Oh my gosh. Tyler, you can stand up here too if you want. You just did such a good job. Great. And John, did we end up opening up the voting? Okay, voting is now open. So while we do this, everybody can vote. So first, I wanna just point out that everything we do here tonight is authentic. We want to make sure that, you know, you don't feel like anything's being forced upon you with this Q&A. There's no reason we would plant anybody in the audience to ask the first question so that this goes over smoothly and encourages other people to do it. So does anybody have a question for the creators? Yeah, the man all the way in the back, I don't know, who is not engaged.
Yes, Noah. John, I want to ask you, was your film inspired by your own interest in the subject, or was it just a pet project that you thought you could do a really good job on?
That film? Kind of a long story, like really too long to explain it now, but I'd be happy to afterwards. How about that?
Was that me? All right, do we have any other questions after that loud beeping noise? Yeah, donkey. Noah has a mic, and he can come and hand you the mic.
Lucas Souza, how many takes did the finger licking scene take?
Honestly, more than I would like to admit.
How many, Tyler?
It was 3.
Thank you, Tyler.
Is this hello?
I also have a question. John, this is for you, too. I know, sorry. Are you planning on submitting that film to a film festival at all? Or is that something that you're, you know, considering to doing?
Like another film festival?
Like another film festival, like an outside,
yeah, yeah.
Like Toronto film. I think they have one. Isn't that like a good one?
That is the thing. I would like to. I haven't done a whole lot of research on that yet.
No questions? Yeah, Noah's gonna get his cardio in tonight.
Boone, was your story inspired by true events, or where did you get your inspiration from?
So you know that the big metal pie-saw bird up there in the pub? It's like sitting on like the fireplace. I like never noticed that, and then one day I did, and I was like, what if the whole time the pie-saw bird was in the pub? And I know none of that got explained in the film, but that's where the idea came from.
Will you ever make a second movie?
Yeah, I'm thinking of doing a full feature-long movie, which is 15 minutes in my mind, really giving the whole backstory of everything that happened.
Thank you.
Boone, was anyone harmed in the gunfight scene that you guys filmed?
It was a gunfight scene, so I believe everyone was harmed, including a couple pedestrians. But that's okay, because I believe we're all on my parents' insurance plan, so no harm, no foul.
Viviani, what is that cup thing?
It's called a Diva Cup, and it is, yeah, I mean, it's just, rather than applying, like, it's reusable, and so rather than spending your money to buy multiple of different things, you can just use that one item, and personally, I've never used one. So that's that.
Yeah, Viv.
I don't know.
I have a question for Griffin. What inspired you to do, like, to focus on individuals and do, like, individual profiles, and why did you pick the subjects you picked?
I'm sorry, what was the last part of that question? Why did I pick this?
Like, the human subjects.
Oh, well, I started out with photography, and I always felt like, you know, there's, with photos, you know, I really liked shooting portraits, and so, but I always felt like you couldn't really, like, I'd always love to shoot people that I really felt strongly about and really loved, and I really loved their stories, and I really loved the way that they, like, approached and thought about the world. And I always felt like photos were nice, but that doesn't really show the side of the person that I wanted to. And when I got into making little films or whatever, I don't know, this is something that has kind of fascinated me recently. It's kind of like the phase, I guess, I'm going through and what I'm doing. And it's very much about helping maybe people who watch it realize that, like, everyone else is, like, on some journey or path in life, and everyone else is facing challenges, everyone else is questioning things, everyone else has varying, like, views of the world, and I think it's just about, like, maybe creating opportunity for a viewer to relate with somebody, and it's just about sharing. From my perspective, it's about sharing people who I really love and who I really have connected with and think are really awesome, and yeah.
Well, great. So I think that's going to end our Q&A session. I know it's short, but we want you guys to be able to get back, go to bed early tonight to do your homework tomorrow. and so can we just give another round of applause to all the creators for submitting a video? Great, you guys can go sit down. And now comes the fun part where we get to pit them up against each other and decide who has a better video. We're closing the voting now, so if you didn't get a chance to vote, I'm super sorry. Maybe you can sneak it in now. I'm not quite sure how that works. So now we're going to go ahead and introduce some of our judges that we have tonight. Our first judge for tonight, her name is
Tiffini Randolfo.
Yeah, it's Tiffini Randolfo. The Brooks RC, would you please come to the stage?
The next one is, I'm not going to get tricked by this. I know it sounds like Tom, but it's Tom Halsey. Come on up to the stage.
Great. And our last judge for the night looks French in the pronunciation, given the Latin roots.
I took a couple years of French. I can help out with this one. It's Hon Lyons.
Hon Lyons.
Hon Lyons.
Director of Media Services. Would you please come to the stage? You do this. I'm gonna go, yeah.
There are we ready to go for this?
I'm handing you the
trophy. Okay. As you can see, there are three judges' awards. The categories are cinematography, story, and performance. So each of the judges will hand out one. And I'm doing best cinematography. There's a lot to do. By the way, the hat's just because I thought it looked cool. There's no reason for it. Cinematography includes a lot. It's more than just composition and lighting and good audio. It's good movement. It's drawing the people into the scene. It's good transitions. It's music that drives the action and supports the action. So there's a lot to it. And we've got three films that are nominated. The first one is Wood River Station, Becca's Dance, and the third one is Nadja Peshka, 2021. And the award for best cinematography goes to Nadja Peshka, 2021.
Presenting the award for Best Story, and we have three great nominees. It was hard to make the decision. Each one brought us to a place where we learned something. We were able to walk away with some kind of knowledge. We felt brought into the circumstance, and also had some amazing shots of scenery and landscaping, as well as the story itself. So the nominees for Best Story are Wood River Station, Becca's Dance, and Nadja Peshka 2021. And Best Story goes to Wood River Station by John Woodall.
All right, the final award that the judges are responsible for goes to the best performance or acting. It's hard to put a it's hard to put a number on some of those acting skills out there, but we were able to put a couple of numbers on them. So anyway, so the nominations are for the three is Pioneer Salesman Takes Its Toll, Pendulum Trailer, and The 12-Hour Pub Shift, and The Ballad of PJ. And the award goes to the suspense. The best acting award, best performance goes to Pendulum Trailer by Sean Hannan. To say that it goes to Zoe Wade for the best performance in the best performance.
Great. Thank you so much. Is this on? Great. Thank you so much to our judges for doing this, for taking the time out of your day to go ahead and look at all these. And you know, it's a tough, difficult decision. Sorry we got all of your names wrong. But if you don't know these judges, you should definitely get to meet them. They're fantastic people. Thank you guys so much. Okay, now on to the only award that matters. The Voter Choice Award. So for the Voter Choice Award, it was voted on by all of you, and we have three. So we have second runner-up, first runner-up, and the winner, and everybody who gets called today will actually walk home with a trophy. So we're gonna go ahead and get started. I haven't seen these yet, so I'm super curious. For second runner-up, is this so exciting for me?
That's mine. That's mine. Yeah, Hunter, that's mine.
This is the wrong one?
No, I get to do it.
Oh, okay.
Okay, yeah, that's right, let's just make sure. All right. Second runner-up goes to Christian Sklava, 2020.
Great job. Okay, now I finally get to do one, unless Noah says no. First runner-up for tonight, you can have the big one.
Thank you.
So you didn't win, but you got so close. The 12-Hour Pub Shift and the Ballad of PJ Boone Steele.
For our final award of the evening, the best picture, which doesn't make as much sense to me because they were all videos. Can we get a big drum roll, please? Can we get a little bit of shouting? Best picture for Film Festival 2021 goes to Wood River Station by John Woodall.
We're so close. We just gotta do some thank yous and a shameless plug. So first, you know, I think everyone did such a great job with these videos. I was really blown away. I was gonna roast them, but it was kind of hard.
Honestly, I'm more surprised than anything. Like, they were great.
Nice. So can we just get one more round of applause for everybody who participated in the video, acting, writing, directing, Tyler eating Cheetos, Dunkey gunning people down. Okay, and then can we go ahead and also get a round of applause for the judges tonight for taking their time? Thank you so much. And then we're also gonna do another round of applause for Media Services for putting all this on. It takes a lot of work. Thank you guys so much. And finally, can we go ahead and get John Woodall and Lucas down here just to come on the stage for like 10 seconds? It's like far run, I'm so sorry. I also can't see.
They're not even back there.
These guys put on this whole event. They coordinated so much. They made the mistake of hiring me and Noah.
Well, not hiring, because we're not getting paid.
For volunteering me and Noah. And they really did so much to make this happen, and they really have been a huge support to the Principia filming community, so just a round of applause for them.
Hello. So this is my last year as the film club president. Lucas is going to be taking over for me for the next 2 years. So reach out to him in the future.
Can we have one more round of applause for John, please?
So we'll just say thank you all and have a good night. Well, great. Thank you all for coming out here. They don't seem like they have anything else to say. So you are all free to go. Thank you so much. We appreciate the videos. Yay, me and Noah.